Hi, AP Music Theory students. My name is Patrick Conlon, and I'm the Assistant Director of the Academy of Contemporary Music at the University of Central Oklahoma and co-founder of Onyx Lane, a music production and artistic planning company where I write and produce music for feature films, orchestra concerts, and art installations. Today, we'll be exploring what makes melodies sound interesting, specifically how composers use embellishment, motivic transformation, and phrase structure to make melodies that get stuck in your head. So when my artistic partner Christina and I are hired to work on a project, we not only have to come up with good music, but we have to come up with the right music for that project. And that usually means analyzing types of music that already fit the project and figuring out all the important rules and moves that make that music feel however it does to us. And so we actually use all the skills that you're learning in AP Music Theory to figure out what kinds of sounds are happening. The combination of all of these things, how melody, harmony, structure, orchestration, and a thousand other tiny details from dynamics to articulation to phrasing to cultural, socio-economic, geopolitical, weird historical reasons, they all come together to create a distinctive sound, and this is what we usually call style or sometimes genre. So what makes a melody good? And for me, words like good and bad aren't interesting because they don't lead me into a space where I can come up with an artistic voice. And so for me, breaking down the idea of a good melody, I think of two really specific traits. Number one, for me, good melodies are memorable. As a composer, I want you humming that melody. I want it stuck in your head. An old school term for this is an earworm. It's that like melody that just you can't get it out of your head. And number two, I also want the melody to be interesting. Because if something's boring, you just stop paying attention to it. And that's also not what we want. So how can a melody be both simple and interesting at the same time? And let's start with the basic building block for melodies, which is usually called a motif or motive. And a motif or a motive is just a really small unit of music that repeats throughout the piece. When there's only one motive happening throughout an entire piece, we sometimes call it monothematic. And making a monothematic piece of music interesting is really tricky. And so a really awesome example of this, it's totally overused, but a monothematic piece is Beethoven's Fifth Symphony, First Movement. The motive's everywhere, it's what the whole movement's built off of, and it's why theorists really love using that in their classes. So the motive for Beethoven 5, ba-ba-ba-bum, that's the motive. Ba-ba-ba-bum, 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 ba-ba-ba-bum. You can see the whole thing is just that motive over and over again. And so what he's doing to make that four-note motive interesting for the whole time is he's taking it and transposing it, inverting it, slowing it down, speeding it up, doing all sorts of things to create a piece that feels cohesive because it all comes from that one melodic motive. And also interesting because it keeps changing and transforming throughout the piece. Another thing with motives, when they represent a specific character or thing in a movie or opera, we usually call it a leitmotif, a character theme, or an idée fixe. And which name you use just depends on what century or what country it was written in. This is super helpful for big, large-scale stories where there's a ton of characters spread across hours and hours of narrative. Some really great examples of this are the Star Wars Imperial March by John Williams. Whenever that comes, you know Darth Vader's there. Hector Berlioz's Symphonie Fantastique, and then pretty much anything by Richard Wagner. He kind of went crazy with the leitmotif thing, and like every spear and sword and dragon and character's helmet, they all get their own theme, and that's kind of how he built the whole thing around. This is really important in movie music. So let's go back to how something can be both simple and interesting at the same time. And so breaking it down a little bit more, if a melody is going to be simple and memorable, it needs to be simple, like it's not too complex, but it's distinctive somehow. There's something that makes it catch your ear. It has to be repeated a bunch, because in music and movies and theater and anything that goes through time, the way we build structure is by repetition. It's the only move we have to create cohesion. And then using that repetition to build longer phrases or melodies. And so taking that little motive and just piecing it together in different ways to create these long phrases. And then to make something complex and interesting, it means that each time the motive comes back, it has to be a little bit different. It has to be changed a little bit. And so by doing that, it creates this feeling of like, it just feels like this organic sound that's happening in the piece because you're doing all these things from this one little unit of sound. So let's start super basic. We're going to take a look at how Twinkle Twinkle Little Star built a catchy melody out of two motives. Now, I would argue that Twinkle Twinkle Little Star, despite the fact that it's a children's rhyme, is a super catchy melody because everyone knows it. So let's look at it. If it was just a monothematic piece, if it only had one motive, it would sound pretty boring. Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are, up above the world so high, like a diamond in the sky. It's just boring. As soon as it repeats three times, we're like, okay, I'm bored. So if we decide to make life easy on ourselves, unlike the Beethoven piece, we can start with two motives to build phrases out of. And this is kind of the most used way in Western music for people to build melodic phrases, is they'll take two pieces, two motives, and build a phrase out of it. So in the case of Twinkle, there are two definite motives, and we're going to call them motive A and motive B that they built the overall melodic phrase from. So this is the A motive, this is the B motive. So before we go to what's happening in Twinkle, I want to look at the two most popular ways to put together an 8-bar melody out of two motivic ideas. Option one is called a period, and the phrase structure goes A, B, A, B. It's called a period because it means that it's periodic, meaning it repeats A, B, and then A, B again. So let's hear option one, where Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star is sung as if it was a basic period. So it would go, Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are, up above the world so high, like a diamond in the sky. It's pretty close, but it's not what they actually do. It's a little more interesting for sure, but still a little boring. There's another really popular one. This is called a sentence. It's another way to build phrases out of two motives. And it's a little bit of a different structure. It goes your basic idea, which is your motive, the repeat of that basic idea, fragments of that idea, and then a cadence. And so you can tell this is a little bit harder to understand. It's because these were come up by different theorists who were coming up with things at different times. The theorist who came up with the sentence actually disagreed with the idea of periods, but all of his theory stuff didn't catch on, and so now we use both, and it's just confusing. But the sentence, let's sing it. So basic idea, repeat of that basic idea, fragment, fragment, cadence. So it would go, twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are, up above the world so high, like a diamond in the sky. You can see a little bit different, and you can see how really easily we're building an 8-bar phrase out of these two motives. So let me sing those two really quick just so you get it in your ear for what a period is. So period, twinkle, 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 little star, how I wonder what you are, up above the world so high, like a diamond in the sky. And sentence, twinkle, 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 little star, how I wonder what you are, up above the world so high, like a diamond in the sky. So neither of those are exactly what the original melody is. So let's figure out what's actually happening with Twinkle. So there's the two motive phrases. So if we sing it, twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are, up above the world so high, like a diamond in the sky. Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are. We can see it's not an 8 or 4-bar melody. It's actually a 6-measure melody. And so this is proof that even the simplest of catchy melodies usually have some secret fancy bits to keep them interesting. In the case of Twinkle, Twinkle, it goes A, B, 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 A, B. And so as a composer, when I'm trying to figure out how someone else wrote music so I can do something similar, I'm trying to backwards engineer how we got to the 6-bar phrase. So I try to look at what the most simplified 4 or 8-bar version of that melody would be. And if we take out measure 3 and 4, we find out that we're actually left with the period structure we were talking about before. That's the only weird part in this. And so what do we call measure 3 and 4? How can we label them so we know what's happening to the phrase? There's actually three different words used to define extra measures that have been added either at the beginning, in the middle, or at the end of a phrase. These have specific names in this system of music theory. And these names are, if the measures are added at the beginning, it's called an introduction. If the extra measures are added in the middle of the phrase, it's called an interpolation. And if the extra measures are added at the end of the phrase, it's called an extension. So what would we call measure 3 and 4 of Twinkle? Feel free to pause the video and figure it out. So if you figured it out, it's an interpolation since it happens in the middle of the phrase. And for me with music theory, I always try and get past the kind of big vocabulary terms and just try and get to the kind of simplistic of like, what are we actually describing? And so interpolation is kind of a funky word, but really all we're saying is we need a different word that means you either added the measures at the beginning, in the middle, or at the end. And so when you can simplify that and really get to what the root of what you're trying to do is, it really makes music theory come to life for me. So now that we've identified some of our melodic phrase tools and definitions using a really simple example, let's look at a piece that my partner Christina and I recently wrote and break down how we use music theory to write music that not only sounded like a specific historical style of melodic writing, but also felt like that music as well. So in this case, we were asked to write in a kind of 19th century French Romantic tradition. It's a Western classical style of music. We're using mostly functional, but just starting to trend in the modalish French harmonic language that Debussy and Ravel eventually start really investigating. And there's a clear difference between the melody in the right hand and the harmony in the left. It's got a very simple, but also very flowing melody. And the feeling for me needed to be a little nostalgic, a little melancholic, like I'm remembering something beautiful that happened, but I'm also sad that it isn't there anymore. So let's take a listen. So even though this is a more complicated piece, we're still going to do the exact same thing that we did with Twinkle. So first thing we're going to do is we're going to identify what are the two motives that we're using to put together this first phrase. And so motivic development and transformation, it's only one way to create an organic sounding natural phrase, but it is a really efficient one, especially if you're writing in this kind of Western classical idiom. So in yellow, I've marked motive one. It's a pretty distinctive motive, both because of the rhythm and because of the combination of leaps and steps up. So that's this one. That's our first motive. And then in blue, we've got motive two. It's a little simpler, but it's definitely defined by stepping down. See, all of those are kind of stepping down. So motive one, and then motive two. And And you notice that there is some motivic transformation going. Measure 2 and 3 are really similar, but they're not identical. And then measure 4 and measure 8 are a little bit different because they're cadencing, but there's still a little bit of the original motive in measure 4 and that kind of jump up in measure 8. And so let's figure out the phrase structure on this just like we did before. So measure 1 through 3 repeats at measure 5 through 7. When you see that, it's a big hint that you're probably dealing with, what do you think, either a period or a sentence? Now, these are confusing, but if you guessed period, you were right. And the biggest hint for a period is that the 4 or 8 bar chunk that is half of the phrase repeats halfway through. So you can see measure 1 is the same as measure 5. Measure 2 is the same as measure 6. Measure 3 is the same as measure 7. It's really simple when you break it down, but it's just that kind of, that's the big hint that you're probably dealing with a period phrase structure. And then the other thing to notice, and this is a big thing with melody, especially for composers and songwriters, is that the two motives both balance and contrast each other. So you notice that motive 1 goes up. Motive 2 goes down. Motive 1 is leaping up. It's going up by big steps. Motive 2 is stepping down. And so this contrast and balance is a really important part of this. And you notice this is true in Twinkle as well. There's a jump that goes up, and then the B melody is a stepping way that goes down. And it's really part of what makes it sound like there's balance and it works with the piece. So we've covered how to combine motives into an interesting phrase, but now let's get on how to make a melody hummable and human-sounding and something that gets stuck in your ears. So two tricks for making a melody hummable are contour and range. Range is a really simple one. We just look at the highest and lowest notes of the phrase and use that to figure out the range. In this case, both appear in the cadences. If you look at measure 4, it has that C sharp, that's the lowest note. And if you look at measure 8, it's got that high E that's in that dyad with the C sharp. So those are the two highest notes. And that's a big moment. I mean, like, that's part of what makes the cadences sound like they're an end. And you know the same thing with balance. One is the lowest note in measure 4. Then in measure 8, we have the highest note with the E. That's the range of a minor tenth. You know, that's just, you know, from here. It's not a huge range. It's definitely singable by most people. But if we take out those two measures, we notice that the entire melody is actually just in the range of a minor seventh. It's just from this E to this D, and then it just works its way back down. Those three measures, it's called an arch form usually. Sometimes I think of it as a sigh, because it feels kind of like, you know, you're breathing in. Now you're letting it out. And that's where the emotional and the kind of human element's really important, that the music is also kind of emulating something that's more than just kind of a pure music theory move. You're using music theory in order to create something human, create art. And so having that range be small makes it singable, it makes it hummable, and it's part of what makes something catchy. You get something that's like, it's not hummable, so it's hard for that to be catchy. Now, it can be groovy, it can be all sorts of things, but it's probably not going to be hummable and catchy. So let's get into some more secrets into this melody, and specifically I want to get into what gives it the French character that we were going for. And one of the elements that sounds so distinctively French in the music of Debussy and Ravel is the use of what's called chordal harmony. That is, harmonies that are built out of stacking perfect fourth intervals rather than major and minor thirds. So most of the harmonic language that you're learning, you know, major and minor triads, all of those things are built on the idea of stacking different types of thirds to create harmonies. Chordal harmony is kind of like entering a whole different world of harmony where you're saying the third isn't what we're stacking perfect fourths. There's a really great etude for this that's specifically on chordal harmony by Debussy if you want to listen to that. And just kind of talk about other things in this genre. So quintal harmony, quartal harmony is stacking perfect fourths, quintal harmony stacking perfect fifths. This is used a lot in Star Trek. It has this big open space sound. But the most recent one that got really popular is Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild. This calming quintal harmony arpeggio happens all over the piece. It's kind of one of the main characters of the piece. And it has to do with quintal harmony being something that's kind of about exploration. It's open. And so whenever you hear this, that's really what they built the whole soundtrack of that piece off of. And it makes sense. They're choosing a music theory term, a sort of harmonic language that fits the character of what they're trying to show in the game or the movie. So talking about those slightly secret motivic devices in this, remember our goal was to do a 19th century French romantic piece on piano. So Debussy and Ravel, that chordal harmony, that doesn't happen until the early 20th century. Really, I mean, a little bit in the late 19th. And so if we do that, we're missing our mark by about 40 or 50 years, as far as like the style of what this piece should be. So rather than do full-on chordal harmonies like Debussy and Ravel would do, we tried to figure out how can we imply that kind of French-sounding chordal influence that because we live, you know, 150 years in the future, we know that's where it's headed. How can we kind of get that in there? And so the trick was the left hand, the harmony, are just triadic harmonies. But the interval of a perfect fourth is kind of the secret theme of the entire melody and all the motives. So these are the first two melodic intervals that are perfect fourths. You get. And then we also get. And so the overall feel of this first measure is, which is a chordal harmony. So pause the video at this point. I want you to go through and see how many of those perfect fourth melodic intervals you can find on this little chunk of the music. All right, have you put that together? If you have, I'll show you what I found. So one of the fun things of this is you get to look a little bit like you've got a wall covered of, you know, this is a perfect fourth and that's a perfect fourth, and your theory stuff starts to look like this at some point. So you can see there's actually a bunch of perfect fourths that are being played, and they don't have to happen right after each other in order to really be strong. You notice like measure three, there's definitely this. There's that perfect fourth sound, and these are using things like passing tones, neighbor tones, embellishments. And you notice on the strong beat of beat one and beat three of measure three, we get that. And so if you look at this, that perfect fourth is really everywhere. It's in all of these kind of strong areas for it. All right, now let me show you. We're going to get even a little bit deeper on this. So for some even more secret motivic devices, here's the final motivic move, and this is called motivic transformation. And what we've done here is we've taken parts of the melody that the two motives created, and we changed their range, what notes they're active on, their rhythm, and really what's happening is we're letting the piece sort of create itself. And this is what makes a piece feel like it has a vibe, feel like it's living in a world and it's all organically coming from itself. It's when, as you're writing the piece, as you do things, you start to reference them more, and it almost starts to feel, as a composer, like the piece starts to write itself at some point. You start to find where the piece is telling you it wants to go. And the real magic trick of this is when we're listening to music, we're not listening to it kind of like there's a note, and then we're surprised by the next note, and then we're surprised by the next note. What our brain is doing is it's actually remembering what just happened in the music and then guessing at what's going to happen next. And so as those patterns are established through repetition, whether that's in your meter, your rhythm, your phrase structure, a motive, we expect that pattern to repeat. And when that pattern is broken, we notice it as a special moment, and then we change our expectation for what will happen next. And this kind of sweet spot between too much repetition, too obvious a pattern, that's when we find something kind of boring and we stop listening, or too little pattern, too little repetition, And so that's when we don't really know what's going on. We're just like, I don't get this music. It's too chaotic for me. That sweet spot of interesting is somewhere between that. And that depends on the listener and the composer and, you know, even what mood you might be in at that time. But that kind of sweet spot between too much repetition and too boring and too little repetition so that the piece doesn't make sense, that's that sweet spot you're trying to find. And what we've done is we've taken these motives and melodies from the first phrase and then sampled and spliced them into different patterns, changed the rhythm slightly, and changed the range. It means that the second phrase feels like it's related to and came organically from the first phrase, because it did. All right, so final kind of meta-motivic thing going on. So we've talked a lot about music theory, things that we can do to make a melody interesting and memorable. And for me as a composer, like I've already said, I always want to use my music theory knowledge in order to create a narrative, an emotional feeling, or a vibe in my music. And so for this piece, there were the sort of historical genre elements that we covered as well. There's song structure, harmonic content, the use of perfect fourths in the melody, but there's also the emotional side of the music. It's supposed to sound melancholic, like a sad memory. I mean, it's not like rage, and it's not an action scene, and it's not happy. It's this kind of sad memory. And so for me, my favorite thing to emulate with that is to think of a sigh. You know, like when you're kind of just bummed out about something, you sort of have this... That's kind of the emotional feeling. And so those first two measures are really doing that. It goes up in pinch and tension, and then it comes down as we release the breath. But even more than that, in the overall structure of the piece, we tried to structure it so the whole piece is kind of sounding like a two-minute sigh. So in greenish yellow, this is, we're zooming out from phrase structure and doing overall song structure now. In greenish yellow, I have the A section marked, and in blue, I have the B section marked. And if you notice, the B section is actually higher in pitch, higher in intensity. You notice that both of the A sections are 8-bar phrases, but the B section is actually a 9-bar phrase. That extension at the end of the phrase is what really makes it feel powerful when we land back on that A section. And the overall structure of the piece is a mirror of the motif itself, just played out over the entire piece. Sometimes this is called thematic repetition. It's used a lot in movies and books as a way of sort of creating a feeling that the whole piece of art is saying the same general thing. And so you'll notice this, especially in really good television shows, they'll have, you know, if one character is dealing with a breakup, then another character is dealing with a breakup as well. And this thematic repetition allows us as artists to kind of say this thing and amplify it and make it feel like the whole art is saying the same thing, even though you're doing it in different ways. So you notice the whole piece goes up and then comes down just like a sigh. So let's take a listen to that really quick. Section. So thank you so much for listening and investigating melodies with me today. I hope you all got some ideas of how I use music theory every day in my own work, and also how music theory can really open our minds to what's happening and how a piece is doing what it does, both emotionally and musically. For me, music theory really comes to life when I tie it to an emotional and personal thing. A chord progression that makes me feel like I'm warm and fuzzy or cold and alone, and then remembering both how to create that chord progression and what feeling I've attached to it, so I know when I'm trying to write something that feels like a certain period in my life, I know how to use music theory to find that sound. And for me as an artist, that's really, I mean, especially when I first started opening up for music theory, exactly where you were, at the end of high school, starting college, when I could tie it to that kind of emotional and personal thing, that's when it really became exciting for me. And I hope you all really continue this, and thank you so much for having me.